In today's free Affinity Photo Tutorial or tutorial, I'm going to show you how to get from this photo into this photo. So we're going to create an amazing black and white landscape long exposure, but I'm also going to be speaking about the equipment, the settings and the techniques that I used to get this photo. Plus, I'm going to show you how I transformed this color photo into an amazing black and white fine art long exposure. Okay, we're going to talk about retouching, we're going to talk about conversion to black and white, about RAW file development into the developer persona, and many tips and tricks. So let's roll the intro and let's start learning plus editing. Hello everybody, this is Strato Ayani from illumius.com, the website and YouTube channel where we create training tutorials like this one for Affinity Photo and photography, of course, for all of you out there in order to be able to grab your camera, take photos and edit them like a pro. So if you are new here, stick around because I'm very sure that you are going to learn some amazing techniques for Affinity Photo today. And if you like this tutorial, don't forget we have a free, full-blown course tutorial at illumius.com on how to create amazing cinematic black and white portraits, but we're going to talk about it later on in the video. So without any further delay, let's dive into Affinity Photo, and I'm going to go over here and pick this RAW file that's the original RAW file that we are going to be working with. Okay, now once I take the file and drop it here into Affinity Photo, so it's going to appear within the develop persona, which is the module that is responsible for helping massaging and fixing our RAW file in order to make further edits within the full Affinity Photo suite. Okay, so as you can see right off the bat, we have some small problems. For example, the horizon is slightly tilted to the right. We have some, let's say, dust specks on top of the photo, these black spots over here. We have to actually brighten up the whole photo and maybe bring back some detail from the sky. So we're going to fix all this into the developer persona. The first thing that I want to do is I want to go over here to the crop tool and from here click on the straighten button. This will give me the ruler tool, which works like this. You are going to left click at any point in the horizon at one edge of the frame, and you are going to click and drag following the angle and the direction, let's say, of the horizon as best as possible. And when you release the button, the photo is going to automatically twist and turn in order to make the horizon perfectly straight. All right? But as you can see here, there are some empty spaces because we rotated the photo into the canvas, especially in the corners over here, here and here. So in order to avoid these corners, we are going to click at the crop mode. We are going to select original ratio, and I'm slightly going to click and drag from the corners in order to make the photo a little tighter and also leave outside these empty areas over here. Of course, you don't have to crop as much as I do here. I'm simply cropping a lot here because I want to slightly change the composition and bring this piece of wood closer to the viewer. Okay? Once you do that, you can hit the enter button and it will automatically, as you can see here, crop the photo and bring it a little closer. Now, let's fix a few other things. Let's go to the shadows and highlights tab and let's activate it. First of all, let's pull the highlights to the left and see what happens. Now, we get a lot more detail, but we lose some light. And we're going to fix this by going over here at the exposure slider and we'll drag it slightly to the right to bring back some light to the photo. And maybe I will bump up the brightness a bit and also move the black point to the right to bring back some contrast. Now, because I'm going for a black and white look, I'm going to click on the tones over here, tab. I'm going to click on the black and white panel to activate it. And there you go, now you have a black and white photo. But we need to add some contrast and punch, so we can play around with these sliders, which as you can see, affect the brightness of specific areas within the photo. And more specifically, the red slider controls the areas that contain red, and if we move it to the left, it will make these parts that contain red darker. If we move it to the right, it will make those parts that contain red brighter. And as you can see now, because we moved the red slider to the right, we have more contrast over here on the sky area. So you can play around with the sliders and see what affects your photo and how you feel about it. For example, if I take the blue and drag it to the left, I'm going to get more detail here at the mountain area, and I want that. I want to have something in the background to guide the eye. If we do the same with the cyan, it will make the mountains even more prominent, but we lose the feeling of distance. I mean, we want to have the mountains to be a bit faded away so we can get this sense of distance. So I'm going to actually take the cyan and drag it all the way to the right to make them a tiny brighter, and maybe bring back the blues as well. Okay, and I'm going to play with the magenta, which does absolutely freaking nothing because we don't have any magenta colors within the photo, and with the yellow, which has a lot of it, as you can see here, and it's going to make our photo significantly different. So maybe I will just bump to the right just a little bit this slider to make the photo overall brighter. Okay, so we need to fix these spots, but I'm not going to do it here. I'm going to keep this edit for Affinity Photos, let's say, more flexible retouching tools. And let's try maybe bump up the contrast just a little bit to bring some life to the photo. Let's bump up maybe the shadows just a little bit. And I believe there you have it. This is it for now. Now I'm going to hit the develop button, and the photo is going to open within the native Affinity Photo environment. Okay, so we have our full array of tools in order to play around with this image. Now the first thing that I want to do is I want to get rid of all these spots. Okay, and the safest and most non-destructive way to do it, non-destructive ways, is to click over here to create a new pixel layer. Renaming it to spot removal. Okay. And then we're going to select from here. From here. I keep confusing lately these tools. Now I'm going to click here in the in paint brush tool. And I want to make sure at the options over here that my hardness is around 60%, because I want a soft edged eraser brush, opacity and flow at 100%, and make sure that this option over here, which is the most important options, is set to current layer and below, because if you leave it into the current layer, it's going to do absolutely nothing, because it's trying to retouch only the empty layer, and because it's empty, it doesn't do anything. But if you click on the current layer and below, it's going to use all the layers and it's going to retouch the photo. So if I click here, it's going to work, okay? So I'm going to click here. I'm simply left click on the dot, okay? And as you can see, I am actually retouching the areas. Now, for some reason, this happened, so I'm going to undo it, okay? And if you want to make the brush larger or smaller, you can use the left and the right square bracket keys on your keyboard to work quickly. So I'm simply going to click here. I'm going to click here. I'm going again to click here. You get the point. All right, now, if I want to actually get rid of this line, I can click and drag and I can paint an area, and Affinity Photo will try and do its best to erase this, let's say, spot. And usually it does an amazing job. The algorithm is great. Sometimes I find it to be even better than the one that exists within Photoshop. So I highly recommend this tool, and because I don't want to bore you to death, I'm going to just do a few clicks here, and then we are going to move on with our next technique, which is going to create some interesting drama. Whoa, what was that? I'm sorry. It's going to create some interesting drama, and it's going to make the photo really, really pop. Okay? So with the magic of montage, going to jump right now into the next part of this video. Okay, there you have it. Now the photo is very clean, as you can see, and if you want to see before and after, this is a before and after, before, and after, before, and after. Okay? Huge, huge change. Now that we are done with these kind of things, we're going to use some local editing techniques. For example, I want to make the sky a little darker there, and I want to create a soft vignetting around the photo. So I'm going to click here, I'm going to select the exposure adjustment, and I'm going to drag it slightly to the left until everything is a lot darker. Now, because I don't want to apply this effect to the whole photo slash frame, I'm going to select the mask of the exposure adjustment layer. I'm going to hit Ctrl-I to invert the mask, and this will hide the effect that I just created. And then I'm going to select my brush tool. I'm going to use an opacity of, as you can see here, 50%. No, so 15%, opacity, flow 100, hardness 0, and I'm going to use a large brush. I'm going to make sure that my foreground color here is white. This is important because wherever I paint with my brush with white color into the mask, the same area in the photo becomes darker. Okay, so I am applying using the white brush the effect on specific areas within my photo. So I have total control of it. Okay, and I'm going to click and drag many times. I'm going to do many passes here at the sky and maybe here around the wood. Okay, so I want to create something like a vignette. Now, if I want, I can double click here at the exposure adjustment and I can make things even darker, as you can see here. And if you want this effect to be more natural, you can go to the exposure adjustment mask, click on the mask, then go over here to the live filters, select Gaussian blur, and we're going to blur it all the way to 100. And as you can see, it makes the edges of the mask less prominent, okay? It makes them blend better with the photo. It's not perfect, we're going to fix it, but this is a very good start. Of course, you can go over here and type something like 500 pixels and hit the enter button, and it's going to blur everything even more, all right? Now, if you see some strange artifacts happening at the edge of the frame, make sure you click on the preserve alpha button over here in order to make things look a lot better. Also, if you want to take away the effect from this area of the frame, okay, if you want to undo it, hide it, you can click on the mask, bring the black color here as a foreground color, and use the same brush in order to paint with black, and black means we're going to hide this effect from this area in case we don't like it that much, okay? So I'm simply going to paint with black here, and it is a good idea to disable for now the Gaussian blur in order to be able to work faster. And if you want to completely and quickly erase this part of the darkening effect, you need to go to the opacity slider at the brush, make it 100%, use the black color and paint around this area in order to hide this effect with the 100% black color that you throw into the mask. Okay, let's activate the Gaussian blur again. So this part is going to blend better within the with the photo. And now let's bump the contrast just a little bit because we need some punch. So I'm going to use my favorite contrast tool, the curves. I'm going to move it over here. Click here where these two lines intersect. Click here where these two lines intersect to create new control points. Click and drag this control point downwards. Click and drag this control point upwards, okay? This control point makes everything that is dark darker if you drag it downwards. This control point makes everything that is bright even brighter. So there you have it. Now, I need to make the water look a lot smoother, okay? And here's the secret on how to do it. You're going to select the background layer that contains my photo, okay? And then I'm going to click over here and select the live Gaussian blur filter. I'm going to click on it. I'm going to bump up the radius to something like, I don't know, maybe even 100. I'm going to click on the preserve alpha option because I want to get rid of the artifacts and the transparency that you see around the edges of the frame, okay? And then I'm going to hit Control I on the Gaussian blur live filter in order to hide it behind the black mask. And then, once again, I'm going to take my brush tool, I'm going to pick as a foreground color the white color, I'm going to lower my opacity to something like 20%, and I'm carefully going to paint this effect on top of the water. And it's going to make the water look a lot smoother. So you're going to get this nice, ethereal, let's say, looking water that you love and see and like and desire on other people's photos, okay? And if you want to make it even more prominent and work faster, go all the way to 100% and simply just paint your heart out here on these areas that have water. Now, you have to be careful to stay around the wood. If I was doing this in a professional matter, I would probably make a selection of the water or a selection of the wood to protect it, okay? But since this is a YouTube tutorial and we have limited time, I'm going to do it like this. I'm going to do it like a non-professional person, okay? Now, if you want, you can double click here at the Gaussian blur, and if you lower this to zero, you're going to see that the water will be a lot more different. So let's go over here, for example. Oh, it doesn't leave me. Yeah, here it is. This is the before, okay? This is the after. As you can see, the water is a lot smoother. It has this fog-like quality, okay? Maybe I missed a few spots. Maybe I need to make this effect better by clicking here. And also make sure that if you mess up and you paint some areas that you don't need to paint, like this area over here on the mountains, all you have to do is switch to the black foreground color, paint away with black, and this is going to save you some troubles, okay? But sometimes you can see you can get a natural result, so this is why I like to lower the opacity to around 50% and do some passes. So I gradually blur this area and it's going to make it look awesome. Okay, now that we have this photo, we can play around with a few more things. For example, I can take this exposure adjustment layer that has this vignetting, okay? I can hit Control J to duplicate it. I can take the Move tool from here and I can rotate it 180 degrees in order to create a darkening effect here at the bottom if I want to. This is a quick and dirty way to create some, let's say, darkening at the bottom of the frame. And of course, I can go all the way here. I can make it a bit larger if I want to. I can lower its opacity, etc., etc., etc. Now, if you're using a lot of live filters and you have a lot of programs open, just like I do right now, because I'm recording, I'm streaming, I'm doing a lot of things at the same time, and you see that the performance is dropping, you can temporarily deactivate the Gaussian blur effect from here. Move the mask or this darkening effect where you want, transform it, make it, let's say, less prominent by lowering its opacity, etc., etc. And once you are done, you can reactivate the Gaussian blur effect and it's going to bring back some of that lost performance, okay? Now, here's what I would like to do. I would like to refine this top part over here because I think this angle, it doesn't look very good because it's diagonal. So I'm going to take my brush, okay, and I'm going to use the white color to either bring more blackness towards the center of the frame to make it more gradual. So I'm going to paint with a 40% opacity. I'm going to do a few passes and maybe, just maybe, looks better. Just a tiny bit, I believe so. And then what I'm also going to do is I'm going to try and fix this area and make it, let's say, a little more visually pleasing. So I'm going to click here and I'm going to select this bottom darkening and I'm going to stretch it to the left in order to create this, let's say, nice straight line of shadow that will help me draw the attention towards the wood, okay? So this looks a lot better if you ask me. Now again, I can go over here and I can move this upwards if I want to have more of the sky appear in the bright areas. I can stretch it as well if I want to. I can play around any way I want, okay? It's up to you. Now I'm going to reactivate the Gaussian blur here and here. And what I want to do now is do some final tweaks. For example, I'm going to go at the topmost layer. I'm going to use a curves adjustment layer once more, and I'm going to make the overall image just a little bit brighter. So I'm going to click here. Again, I'm going to select the curves, here it is. I'm going to click at the middle. Whoa, I didn't want to do that. I'm going to click at the middle over here. I'm going to click and drag this control point and drag it to the left and upwards. And as you can see, it's going to make my photo a little brighter. Okay, now this will give some more punch, some more contrast to the photo, and it's going to allow me to get this nice, bright, how do you say it, feeling that you see in this kind of photos, okay? So they're usually kind of dark in the sky and they're very bright at the area where the water flows, there is motion, etc., etc., etc. So let's see the result once more. All right, this is how it looks. Okay, now there are a few tweaks we can do. We can play around with the contrast, we can take a brush and add some sharpness to the wood, we can do a lot of things. But what I want you to remember is that the photo we actually started with, okay, is something like the photo you are going to see, hopefully, right now. It's a photo that was taken with a Sony 6300 with an exposure of 30 seconds, f22, ISO 100, and with a 10 stop ND filter. So we went from this result, which might seem disappointing at the time of the photo shoot, but with some editing magic, we went into this photo. Okay, and there are a lot of things that we can do, but because we are already going for 23 minutes straight, let's stop here. So now you know how to create amazing black and white long exposure shots like this one. You know how to take a photo and transform it into a black and white masterpiece, and you know all the secrets that most landscape shooters use in the editing room in order to get amazing results. And so you can do something similar by using the power of Affinity Photo. Now, if you liked this video, go at illumis.com. We have a full blown course. No bullshit, it's a full course that you can get for free that will help you create some amazing black and white cinematic portraits, okay? Go get this course at illumis.com, it's free, follow the instructions and you can get full access today, and you can learn everything you need to know about how to create dramatic black and white photos and portraits. That was Strato Agiani. This was a big one. If you like longer tutorials like this one, please let me know. If you have any questions, again, please leave a comment down below. I will be more than happy to help you. And until next time, take care, happy editing, and see you in the next one. Ciao.